The next item of business is a statement by Shirley Ann Somerville on Scottish Government response to the Section 35 Order Judicial Review. Members will be aware that some of the content of this statement is in the public domain following media coverage. I have received a letter of apology from the Deputy First Minister, and it is appropriate that an apology is made to the Chamber. Members, I would be grateful if I could make my remarks. I have received a letter of apology from the Deputy First Minister, and it is appropriate that an apology is made to the Chamber. Ministers are answerable and accountable to the Parliament for their actions in their ministerial capacities, and it is essential that members, as elected representatives of the people of Scotland, have the first opportunity to hold ministers to account, and for that reason, announcements must be made here first. Having considered the content of the statement, I consider it important that I allow it to go ahead in part, and I would invite the Cabinet Secretary to focus on those matters that are not already in the public domain. And the Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Shirley Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before I begin my statement, let me respond to your comments. Presiding Officer, media speculation on the Government's decision in relation to the Section 35 is deeply disappointing and regretful. I am aware that the Deputy First Minister responded to direct questions put to her, and whilst she did not confirm or deny if the Scottish Government intended to appeal the decision, she recognised the Government's position was inferred by the comments made. She in no way meant to preempt the statement today, and I know she has written to you to apologise for comments she made in response to the direct questions put to her in interviews on the Budget. I would also like to apologise to you and the Chamber. The discussions between myself and your office, Presiding Officer, did lead to the late arrival to opposition spokespeople, for which I do genuinely apologise for that. Let me now return to my reduced statement. 1 year ago, this Parliament passed the Gender Recognition Reform Scotland Bill after much discussion and careful consideration. Not everyone agreed with the bill, some strongly opposed it. But the will of the Parliament was clear. Two-thirds of this chamber voted to pass the bill, with members of all parties voting in favour. But within 4 weeks, the Secretary of State for Scotland blocked its submission for royal assent with the first ever use of a Section 35 order. Scottish ministers petitioned for judicial review, as it was clear to us that allowing this unprecedented veto on a decision of this Parliament to go unchallenged would undermine the Holyrood's democratic will, and by extension the will of the people we are sent here to represent. First, let me be absolutely clear that the Scottish Government remains committed to supporting and empowering the LGBTQI plus community, including trans people. We will continue to build on our work across government to strengthen this. We work closely with the LGBTQI plus stakeholder group and third sector organisations to ensure the voices of those with lived experience helps improve outcomes for these communities. We are also delivering the Non-Binary Equality Action Plan to improve conditions for non-binary community in Scotland. And the plan includes actions already underway, such as meaningfully including non-binary people in decision-making. We remain committed to consulting on an Ending Conversion Practices in Scotland Bill for both sexual orientation and gender identity. And detailed proposals for legislative change will be published early in the new year. Conversion practices which aim to change or suppress a person's sexual orientation or gender identity are damaging and destructive acts that violate the human rights of those who undergo them. We remain committed to our work with NHS Scotland to improve access to and delivery of gender identity healthcare. And we are working closely with people with lived experience, organisations representing trans people, and NHS Scotland to implement the actions in the 2021 NHS Gender Identity Services Strategic Action Framework. We have established a National Gender Identity Healthcare Reference Group and commissioned a range of work, including robust collation and reporting of waiting times, a transgender healthcare knowledge and skills framework with training opportunities for NHS Scotland staff, a programme of research on long-term health outcomes for people who access gender identity healthcare, and the development of national standards for accessing and delivery of gender identity healthcare. This work is well underway. We are also delivering the recommendations of the LGBTI Inclusive Education Working Group. The Implementation Group has, in partnership with COSLA, promoted effective delivery of LGBT inclusive education in all Scottish schools, engaging with young people to seek their views and experience, and are delivering improved learning environments for all children and young people. And before the end of the parliamentary year, we will bring forward a new Human Rights Bill for Scotland. Let me now turn to the Gender Recognition Reform Bill specifically. The Bill's reforms remain the Government's policy, and as we can see from the cross-party support for the Bill, they remain what this Parliament would like to see enacted. However, the UK Government's intervention means that the Bill cannot proceed to royal assent. It remains a Bill passed by the majority of this Parliament, and we will not be withdrawing it. There is a strong indication that any divergence of approach would be unacceptable to the UK Government. As Alistair Jack stated in the Westminster Parliament, in short, two different regimes create adverse effects. It is therefore impossible to see how progress can be made, particularly when the rules of this Parliament require that amendments at reconsideration stage are consistent with the Bill's general principles as agreed at stage one. Nonetheless, our offer is still there. If the current UK Government is willing to work together on this, we will happily sit down with them. If a future UK Government are willing, we will do so with them, so that the Section 35 could be lifted and the Bill progresses. It seems clear that the current Government will not do this, and it remains to be seen what a future Government will do. Parliamentary discussion of the Scotland Act shows that the Section 35 power was always intended as a long stop or last resort, and one which would never be needed. It was envisaged that the UK Government should raise issues at an early stage and the two governments should seek to resolve them. That is in black and white, both in those devolution debates in the Westminster Parliament in 1998 and in the Memorandum of Understanding between governments. But that is not how the Secretary of State for Scotland used the power. It is the Scottish Government's view that this UK Government and the Secretary of State see Section 35 as a veto that they can apply to any legislation passed by this chamber that they disagree with. To ignore the Memorandum of Understanding sets a very worrying precedent for the democratic powers of this Parliament. Regardless of people's views and opinions on gender recognition, that is a very worrying place for our Parliament to be. Now, due to the intransigence of current UK Government, I'm confident any repetition of our offer to seek compromise would again be rebuffed. We will therefore focus on working with an incoming UK Government, which we hope will have more respect for devolution and is willing to work together, even when at some times we disagree. Now, I recognise that many trans people will be disappointed by this decision. To them, I say this. The Scottish Government will never waver in our commitment to your rights. You deserve to be respected, included and supported. You are not a threat, and you will always be able to live your lives free from prejudice and abuse in the type of Scotland we all want to see. We will continue to work towards a society that is equal and fair, and where people can live as they are, just as we will continue to protect the democratic powers of this Scotland's Parliament.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who wish to put a question were to press the request to speak buttons. And I call Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments in relation to the late arrival of the statement. When Nicola Sturgeon said last year that this debate would be over by Christmas, I don't think she meant this Christmas. The Scottish Conservatives repeatedly told this SNP government that the Gender Recognition Reform Bill was fundamentally flawed. We warned all along that this would happen, but the SNP government didn't listen. Instead, they've spent time and taxpayers' money on a doomed legal battle to revive laws which the majority of the Scottish public do not want. Laws which undermine the rights and safety of women, girls and vulnerable young people. Women's groups were ignored throughout this whole debate, and I'm delighted that their hard-fought campaign has been won. But this whole debacle leaves the SNP's relationship with the Greens in tatters, and I'm wondering if the Greens will follow through on their threat and quit the government after the announcement today. It might be a lot better for Scotland if they did. Cabinet Secretary, we know that self-ID has been a failed experiment that the Scottish public oppose. So can she outline whether lessons have been learned? And if so, can she reassure women's groups that their concerns will be listened to in the future to prevent this sorry saga from ever happening again?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Megan Gallagher for her question and the way for which she took my apology. I know her and I have many crossed words, including yesterday, but I do appreciate the way that she's responded to my remarks today. Can I say, however, that there were not amendments at Stage 3 that would have prevented, I don't think, the Secretary of State from taking a Section 35 order. And the reason I say that is because, as I mentioned in my original statement, he has been clear that he is concerned about a divergence and two systems being within the UK. Now, on that basis, it is genuinely difficult to see how we could have a bill that could be approved by this Secretary of State and in this UK government. When it comes to listening to diverging opinions on this, I know, I appreciate in this Parliament and in wider society, there are a range of opinions on this issue. I fully appreciate that. But those were listened to. We may not clearly have agreed with those, but I met, the now Deputy First Minister met, many ministers met. We had with groups who both agreed and disagreed with where the bill got to. And there were, of course, two public consultations. But I would say, as well, Presiding Officer, on this issue, what this legal judgment is about the use of Section 35. The judgment does not take any position on the Gender Recognition Bill itself and the merits thereof, and that is why the government will not be withdrawing the bill.
Thank you. I call Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I add my disappointment to the late sight of the statement, but also accept what the Cabinet Secretary has said in mitigation. From the beginning of the process of gender recognition reform in Scotland until now, 6 years down the line, Scottish Labour has striven to ensure that the gender recognition reform legislation is progressive and updates the system whilst upholding rights and protections for everyone. We sought to engage all parties, including the government, from the beginning, raising potential issues, offering amendments and seeking repeated assurances that the legislation was secure in law. Indeed, the Cabinet Secretary will recall my own amendments this time last year and previous questions I have raised on issues like Section 104 meetings between both governments and calls to see the government's legal advice. Ultimately, I recognise this will be a difficult day for many people. Simplifying the process for gender recognition has not moved forward, and I welcome the Cabinet Secretary outlining what further action the government will take to support trans people in Scotland, something I have been keen to raise each time we've had the opportunity to discuss the issue. So I would appreciate in her answer if she'd further outline how activity across government will be coordinated so as to measure improvements, particularly in healthcare. I recognise too that many women feel that the debate has dismissed their concerns, and indeed a common view that the debate has become too polarised. The Cabinet Secretary has essentially said that the bill will remain in limbo after the smoke from the court wrangling between the two governments clears. And I also heard what the Cabinet Secretary said about willingness to try and work together. So does she recognise that the court has judged that the bill modifies the law as it applies to reserve matters? And what analysis has the government carried out in light of those parts of the judgment that could form the basis for any future dialogue with the UK government on moving the process forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Paul O'Kane for his questions. With relation to the aspects on health, this is a very important issue, I recognise, for the trans community and something which the government has been working on already for some time. And I think it's important that I recommit the government to that today. I've spoken about the gender identity services and that strategic action framework, and that describes how we are working to improve access to and delivery of NHS gender identity services. And importantly, I think we will continue, I know, to work with those with lived experience to ensure that matters are improved for them, not just in the healthcare sector, but in other aspects as well. He mentioned the Section 104. That's clearly a very different process and a technical process to ensure that bills can work correctly. Unfortunately, that would not have got it out of the situation again that we're in at the moment, because as I've said already, the Secretary of State has made his position clear on having two different systems. But we will continue to work with any government on that issue. And I think it is very important that right across government we do work together to ensure that we are supporting the trans community in everything that we do, as well, of course, as continuing the work and delivering equally safe to protect women's rights and to protect them from violence and intimidation and discrimination.
Thank you. I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This time last year, the majority of MSPs in this chamber voted to respect the right of trans women and men to self-identify in accordance with their human rights. The intervention of the UK government to block this has defied the democracy of this Parliament and shattered the trans community. Can the Cabinet Secretary expand on the decision taken by the government following the legal advice?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, clearly it would be inappropriate for me to discuss the legal advice which the government received. But what I would say, Presiding Officer, is that the judgment not to appeal, or the decision not to appeal this judgment, has not been an easy one. We've, of course, reflected on that legal advice and the policy advice covering a wide range of factors. I know that the legal process, this ongoing scrutiny that it brings, has taken its toll on the trans community. It is the government's opinion, that the worst possible outcome would be to draw this out still further and still not be able to have a bill to enact. We want to avoid that outcome, and that's the reason why the government has came to the decision that it has.
Miles Briggs to be followed by Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When announcing the intention to take the UK Government to court 8 months ago, the Cabinet Secretary did tell Parliament that they were very keen to be transparent as possible on the matter. And whilst the Scottish Government have abandoned this legal battle against the UK Government, can the Cabinet Secretary actually now say whether or not the Government will publish legal advice? And given the Scottish Government have spent over £230,000 of taxpayers' money on this failed court action so far, what will the government also publish what estimated costs would have been incurred by the government if they had challenged this ruling?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've already said, Presiding Officer, the government does not publish its legal advice. Neither will the UK government publish its legal advice about the court decision either. So I do think it's a bit hypocritical for the member to suggest that the Scottish government publishes advice, but I don't think, happy to stand to be corrected, but I don't think he would make the same call on the UK government. And can I say gently, when it comes to wasting public money on court cases, the UK government has spent more than £2 million on a case to ensure that they can, how to take some of the most vulnerable people. You might find this funny, Scottish Conservatives, but I certainly don't. 2 million people to take some of the most vulnerable in our society, those that are persecuted right across the world, and send them to Rwanda was worth £2 million, and you have the hypocrisy to come to this chamber and actually criticise the Scottish government for standing up to the powers of this Parliament. It's a shame the Scottish Conservatives have once again shown that they have no interest in defending this Parliament or democracy, but are quite happy to defend the Rwandan policy on immigration.
I call Karen Adam to be followed by Claire Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I firstly want to acknowledge the harm that this arduous process, particularly the UK government veto and court ruling, has had on trans people, their families and their friends. Can the Cabinet Secretary update the Chamber on the significant impact the Section 35 order has had on devolution after being used in this way?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think Karen Adam is quite right to point out, one, the impact on the trans community in Scotland, but also, importantly, to talk about the impact on devolution. And that is exactly why the Scottish Government took this case in the first place, because we recognised that the UK Government has, unfortunately now, a record of attempting to undermine devolution. And this judgment absolutely is about how the Section 35 was used with respect to the gender recognition. But it is important that we continue in the future also to challenge on Section 35 orders. So I accept the judgment. I accept that Section 35 is part of the devolution process. But to have this being used in the way that it has is a worrying precedent, for anyone that's genuinely interested in Scottish democracy, because there is an emerging pattern of interference. There was no deliberate breaches, presiding officer, for example, of the Sewell Convention for the first 20 years of devolution. Since 2018, we've now seen it breached 11 times. That's what happens when power goes unfettered, and that's why we will continue the challenge to the UK Government, if we choose to do so in the future, on any Section 35 that comes ahead.
Call Claire Baker, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So, a year on from the passing of this legislation, which is a sorry and salutary tale for the Scottish Government, they need to accept and reflect on their level of responsibility, not just for this failed piece of legislation, but how their actions influence wider discussion on this complex and sensitive issue. In her discussion of upcoming work, the Cabinet Secretary did not refer to the upcoming CAST review final report. Can I ask what plans the Scottish Government is making to respond to the CAST review final report, which is due in the new year? And can I also ask if the National Gender Identity Healthcare Reference Group is considering the delivery of gender identity healthcare for children and young people?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Claire Baker for her questions? I think there is something that we all need to reflect on with the Section 35 and the judgment around how this Parliament is treated. Regardless of how people's views were on gender recognition, there is, I think, an ongoing issue we now have over how Section 35 has been ordered. So, yes, clearly the Government will reflect. I would suggest there's a time for reflection for all of us on this. On the CAST review, the Member will be aware the ongoing findings of the CAST review and their implementation by NHS England are being closely considered by the Scottish Government and NHS Scotland. And I would be happy to write to the Member, or indeed to get the Minister more deeply involved in that, to write to the Member on the specifics of that issue.
John Mason, to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you. I think the Cabinet Secretary knows that I was and am opposed to this bill, but Westminster should not be interfering in what is rightly Scotland's business. Is the Cabinet Secretary concerned that future UK governments may just use a veto just because they don't like our legislation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, and I think this is one of the examples where the Member on our high, we fair to say, have completely opposing views on the gender recognition bill, but he is quite right to point to the significance for this on devolution itself. And I think this was rightly also focused on by Mark Drakeford when he said that the UK Government's decision to use the powers that have never been used in the history of devolution is a very dangerous moment. The point I was trying to make to Claire Baker earlier on, this is a turning point in devolution, and it is up to all of us to reflect on what we do about that. Now, the Government has taken this matter to court. We absolutely, as I said, accept the judgment of the court on this and will not appeal. But I do think there is a worrying habit, can I put it, that the UK Government has about interfering in devolution, and I do fear that that habit may increase in the future.
Yeah. Alex Cole-Hamilton, to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Presiding Officer, this bill commanded support from members of all five parties across this chamber because it sought to allow trans people to be recognised for who they are without trauma in the legal architecture that underpins their lives. Many trans people suffer discrimination and stigma every day. This process will have harmed them further and left them feeling let down and exposed. That is a great shame, and a humane approach to gender recognition is a problem that remains unresolved. They are now looking to us for meaningful progress against the other barriers that stand between them and equality, like a ban on conversion therapy and ready access to trans-inclusive healthcare. The Cabinet Secretary touched on some of these in her remarks, but to reassure those watching us today who are hurting, will she commit to a meaningful timeline of action and regular reporting to Parliament on each of these areas?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely. And I think Alex Cole-Hamilton is quite right to begin his remarks by saying that trans people simply want to be accepted for who they are. I think we should all be able to say that about all of our members of society. And I do appreciate they feel let down. they feel exposed and they will feel vulnerable. And there is a responsibility I feel very heavily on me and my government to ensure that we move forward with whatever we can do right across government on this issue. I give one example of that. We've already discussed healthcare, but I give one example again on conversion therapy. And we had fully intended to have that consultation out on the ending conversion practices bill by the end of the year, but we listened to stakeholders' concerns, both from faith groups and from LGBT groups, about the fact that they wished that to be in the new year, particularly because there is a time over Christmas and New Year that people may be feeling particularly vulnerable and may not have support services available. So that consultation is ready. It's absolutely ready to be launched right at the beginning of the new year when Parliament returns. And he has my absolute assurance on that the Minister will be taking that forward in due course. And either she or I would be happy to meet the member to discuss that in further detail.
We have much interest. I'd be grateful if we could have short and concise questions and responses to get as many members in as possible. And I call Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Russell Finlay.
Following the Court's decision on the use of Section 535 to block the GRR bill, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that devolution is fundamentally flawed and that only full independence can ensure that Scotland's democratic decisions are implemented?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I hear groans, Presiding Officer, from that, but they affirm that once again. So let me
let's hear the Cabinet Secretary.
Let me be very clear, Presiding Officer. If the Scottish Conservatives don't want the conclusion to be that we need independence to ensure that the will of the Scottish Parliament is recognised, then they also have to reflect on the fact that Section 35 is a part of the devolutionary setup, but how it is used is a very, very important to how this Parliament feels it's been treated and the respect that this Parliament is given. So anyone that's interested in actually getting devolution to work, which allegedly the Scottish Conservatives do, then they would actually also wish to reflect on the use of Section 35 as it goes forward and prove us wrong, prove there is a way to get devolution to work, because until then, the member is quite correct that only with independence will we have Scotland's democratic decisions implemented.
I call Russell Finlay to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Women across Scotland were told that their views were not valid. So I applaud their hard-won victory with the SNP's dangerous GRR bill in the bin where it belongs. But I would like the Cabinet Secretary to explain why female prisoners are still being used as guinea pigs in the SNP's gender self-ID experiment. Why should the most vulnerable women in society be told to accept that a rapist like Isla Bryson or any other male-bodied sex criminal is a woman?
Cabinet Secretary.
Once again, for the avoidance of doubt, Presiding Officer, this bill is not in the bin and it awaits an incoming UK government that has more respect for devolution. Yeah. Can I also point out to Russell Finlay that the examples that he gives are under a gender recognition certificate process that is there throughout the UK, that is also there for many, many years. So what has happened within the Scottish Prison Service has nothing to do with gender recognition certificates, and he should not conflate the issues. He will also be well aware of the recent Scottish Prison Service policy on this, and I would refer him, if he's genuinely interested in the safety of women and transgender prisoners, to look at that in detail.
Maggie Chapman to be followed by Ash Regan.
Thank you. The court ruling 12 days ago came as a bitter blow to trans people across Scotland. I know many of them are feeling very hurt and vulnerable right now, and they now have to wait indefinitely for the reforms that the legislation we passed here overwhelmingly 12 months ago would have delivered. Trans people are targets just because of who they are. Given that their lives have been and continue to be weaponised as part of a toxic culture war, what assurances can the Cabinet Secretary give to trans people who need some hope, some clear demonstration that they matter and that we value them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Maggie Chapman for her question and put on record my thanks to her for all the work that she has done on this issue over the years. And I look forward to continuing to work with her as we move forward to protect and enhance the trans rights. It is very important that we do provide the reassurances that she asked for. I hope that my words today in some way go to reflect my concern over the trans community's vulnerability at this difficult time and the government's commitment on this issue.
I call Ash Regan to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
Last year, the Scottish Government told us it's just a small admin change. It grants no new rights. It does not interfere with the operation of the Equality Act. Safeguards are not required. No evidence of harm to women, all of which were wrong. This sorry and sad episode has created a culture where women were dismissed as transphobes and bigots. The Scottish Government failed in its duty to analyse the potential impact on women, and they misled this Parliament. They must provide clarity on next steps, as this bill must never be implemented. I renew my calls for the government to apologise, as their conduct has fatally undermined public trust in government, and they have no one to blame for that but themselves.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would say to the member that although the Scottish Government introduced this bill, it was passed by Parliament. This is now Parliament's bill, and this government will protect the will of Parliament in any way we can. I would also say to the member, as I've said before, that this judgment was about how the Section 35 was used with respect to GRR. It did not discuss the merits of the bill itself, and it's very important that these two items are not conflated.
Thank you. I call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I fully welcome the Scottish Government's ongoing commitment to LGBTQ people and hope that the trans community will be offered the relevant support in the days and weeks following these events. Can the Cabinet Secretary share further information on the reason behind the Government's decision not to appeal?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I've laid out already in some of my answers, Presiding Officer, the decision for that was one for the Government taking a view of not just the legal advice but the policy advice we had, reflecting on that and reflecting on our views that to carry this process on would impact again negatively on the trans community, and we feared that the bill, because of the Secretary of State for Scotland's intransigence on this issue, would still not be able to pass, and it is for those reasons we chose not to appeal.
Call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you,
Thompson.
Presiding Officer. The Scottish Conservatives warned time and time again that the SNP Green Gender Self-ID Bill threatened women's single-sex spaces, and that was proven by the case of Isla Bryson, and would have impacted on equality laws right across the United
Members.
Kingdom. If the SNP was so caring of the impact of their GRR bill on vulnerable women, why did they vote against these key amendments?
Cabinet Secretary.
Again, Presiding Officer, I fully respect that the Member and I have very different opinions on this bill. And I appreciate there are different views on this bill. But I am very, very firm, once again, on my opinion that we can improve the rights of trans people in our society, one of the most vulnerable and marginalised groups in our society, while ensuring that we protect women's rights as well. And I would make the point, Presiding Officer, that there are no amendments that came forward at Stage 3, even if the Government had accepted all of them, that would have prevented a Section 35, yep, based on the Secretary of State, yep, firmly believing, as he has said in the House of Commons, that he does not believe in having two systems within the United Kingdom. And on that basis, that is where we run into an intractable problem. But that is why we will continue, yes, to support trans rights, but also always to support women's rights and protect women from discrimination.
I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Douglas Ross.
Regardless of the various views of the Gender Recognition Reform Bill, I think we can all agree it didn't quite work out as intended, and indeed it's left its soured relationships across multiple groups in our society. Our job is simple: to scrutinise and pass good, competent law at best value to the public purse. With this in mind, will the Cabinet Secretary outline what specific review processes the Scottish Government plans to undertake on its role and the outcome we have here today?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, again, I would say to the member, I think we are in danger of conflating a judgment which was based on the use of the Section 35 order on Gender Recognition Bill on the merits of the Gender Recognition Bill itself. The bill, as it was passed by the vast majority of this Parliament, remains a bill that this government would like to see implemented. So, of course, we will reflect on this judgment. Of course we will. But we will also, very importantly, reflect on the use of the Section 35 order and how that impacts on the devolutionary process, because that is what the judgment was all about.
And Douglas Ross.
The Cabinet Secretary has spoken a lot today about diverging views and having respect. Many women and girls oppose the SNP Green legislation to protect their rights and safety. Therefore, on behalf of the Scottish Government, will she thank them for everything she did during the course of the passage of this bill for standing up for those freedoms?
Cabinet Secretary.
So there were obviously diverging views within the Scottish Conservatives on this bill, as well as members of Douglas Ross's group voted for it, and the majority, I accept, voted against. And what I would say is that every single member of this Parliament, I have no doubt, presiding officer, respects the rights of women and respects their need for protection against discrimination and violence. And that is something which this government, and I think this Parliament, has already demonstrated on many occasions in the past and will continue to do so in the future.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement. Point of order, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Throughout the previous statement, the Cabinet Secretary made reference to the fact that there were no amendments presented at Stage 3 that would have not resulted in divergence from UK legislation. There were. They were presented in my name. Thank you.
I thank Ms Webber for her contribution. I do not believe it's a point of order, but it is on the record. We will now move on to the next item of business, which is Stage 3 proceedings on the Trusts and Succession Scotland Bill. I'll allow a couple of minutes for front benches to organise themselves.